Pride and Prejudice by Jane Austen. It is a truth universally acknowledged that a single man in possession of a good fortune must be in want of a wife. "My dear Mr. Bennet," said his lady to him one day, "have you heard that Netherfield Park is let? It's taken by Mr. Bingley, a young man of large fortune from the north of England. You must visit him."
"I see no occasion for that," replied Mr. Bennet.
"But consider your daughters."
"They have none of them much to recommend them."
"Mr. Bennet, how can you abuse your own children in such a way? You take delight in vexing me. You have no compassion on my poor nerves."
"You mistake me, my dear. I have a high respect for your nerves. They are my old friends. I have heard you mention them with consideration these 20 years at least."
Mr. Bennet was so odd a mixture of quick parts, sarcastic humour, reserve and caprice, that the experience of 23 years had been insufficient to make his wife understand his character. Her mind was less difficult to develop. The business of her life was to get her daughters married. Its solace was visiting and news. The Bennets were the principal family of the Hertfordshire village of Longbourn, just outside the market town of Meryton. Mr. and Mrs. Bennet had 4 daughters, more or less grown up. Jane was the eldest, followed by Elizabeth, Lydia, and Catherine. The 5th daughter, Mary, was as yet of insufficient stature to make her mark in society. Word spread like wildfire that Mr. Bingley meant to be at the next Meryton Assembly Ball. When his party entered the Assembly Room, it consisted of Mr. Bingley, his 2 sisters, the husband of the eldest, and another young man. Mr. Bingley was good-looking and gentlemanlike. His sisters were fine women, with an air of decided fashion. His brother-in-law, Mr. Hurst, merely looked the gentleman, but his friend, Mr. Darcy, soon drew the attention of the room by his fine, tall person, handsome features, noble mien. And the report, which was in general circulation within 5 minutes after his entrance, of his having 10,000 a year. He was looked at with great admiration for about half the evening, till his manners turned the tide of his popularity, for he was discovered to be proud. Mr. Bingley had soon made himself acquainted with all the principal people in the room. He was lively and unreserved, danced every dance, and talked of giving a ball himself at Netherfield. Mr. Darcy danced only once with Mrs. Hurst, and once with Miss Bingley, declined being introduced to any other lady, and spent the rest of the evening in walking about the room, speaking occasionally to one of his own party. His character was decided. He was the proudest, most disagreeable man in the world, and everybody hoped that he would never come there again. Elizabeth Bennet had been obliged, by the scarcity of gentlemen, to sit down for 2 dances, and during part of that time, Mr. Darcy had been standing near enough for her to overhear a conversation between him and Mr. Bingley.
"Come, Darcy, I hate to see you standing about by yourself in this stupid manner. You'd much better dance."
"I certainly shall not. You know how I detest it unless I'm particularly acquainted with my partner. Your sisters are engaged, and there's not another woman in the room whom it would not be a punishment to me to stand up with."
"I would not be so fastidious as you are," cried Bingley, "for a kingdom. Upon my honour, I never met so many pleasant girls in my life as I have this evening."
"You are dancing with the only handsome girl in the room," said Mr. Darcy, looking at the eldest Miss Bennet, Jane.
"Oh, she's the most beautiful creature I ever beheld. But there's one of her sisters sitting down just behind you, who's very pretty, and I dare say very agreeable. Do let me ask my partner to introduce you."
"Which do you mean?"
Turning round, Darcy looked for a moment at Elizabeth, till, catching her eye, he withdrew his own and coldly said,
"She's tolerable, but not handsome enough to tempt me, and I'm in no humour at present to give consequence to young ladies who are slighted by other men. You'd better return to your partner and enjoy her smiles, for you're wasting your time with me." Mr. Bingley followed his advice. Mr. Darcy walked off,
and Elizabeth remained with no very cordial feelings towards him. She told the story, however, with great spirit among her friends, for she had a lively, playful disposition which delighted in anything ridiculous. When Jane and Elizabeth got home, the former expressed to her sister how very much she admired Mr. Bingley. "He's just what a young man ought to be," she said. "Sensible, good-humoured, lively, and I never saw such happy manners, so much ease, with such perfect good breeding." "He's also handsome," replied Elizabeth, "which a young man ought likewise to be, if he possibly can. His character is thereby complete." "As for his sisters," Jane resumed, "they are very pleasing women when you converse with them." Elizabeth was not convinced. Their behaviour at the assembly had not been calculated to please in general, and with more quickness of observation and less pliancy of temper than her sister, she was very little disposed to approve them. They were, in fact, proud and conceited. They were rather handsome, had been educated in one of the first private seminaries in town, had a fortune of £20,000, were in the habit of spending more than they ought, and of associating with people of rank, and were therefore, in every respect, entitled to think well of themselves, and meanly of others. Mr. Bingley had inherited property to the amount of nearly £100,000 from his father. Miss Bingley was by no means unwilling to preside at his table, nor was Mrs. Hurst, who married a man of more fashion than fortune, less disposed to consider his house as her home when it suited her. Mr. Bingley had not been of age 2 years when he was tempted to look at Netherfield House. He was pleased with the situation and the principal rooms, satisfied with what the owner said in its praise, and took it immediately. Between him and Darcy, there was a very steady friendship, in spite of a great opposition of character. In understanding, Darcy was the superior. Bingley was by no means deficient, but Darcy was clever. He was, at the same time, haughty, reserved, and fastidious, and his manners, though well-bred, were not inviting. In that respect, his friend had greatly the advantage. Bingley was sure of being liked wherever he appeared. Darcy was continually giving offence. Within a short walk of Longbourn lived a family with whom the Bennets were particularly intimate. Sir William Lucas was, by nature, inoffensive, friendly, and obliging. Lady Lucas was a very good kind of woman, and not too clever to be a valuable neighbour to Mrs. Bennet. They had several children. The eldest of them, Charlotte, a sensible, intelligent young woman of about 27, was Elizabeth's intimate friend. That the Miss Lucases and the Miss Bennets should meet to talk over the ball was absolutely necessary, and the morning after the assembly brought the former to Longbourn to hear and to communicate.
"If I were as rich as Mr. Darcy," cried a young Lucas who came with his sisters, "I should not care how proud I was. I would keep a pack of foxhounds and drink a bottle of wine every day."
"And if I were to see you at it," said Mrs. Bennet, "I should take away your bottle directly."
The ladies of Longbourn soon waited on those of Netherfield. The visit was returned in due form. Miss Jane Bennet's pleasing manners grew on the goodwill of Mrs. Hurst and Miss Bingley, and though the mother was found to be intolerable, and the younger sisters not worth speaking to, a wish of being better acquainted with them was expressed towards the two eldest. By Jane, this attention was received with the greatest pleasure, but Elizabeth still saw superciliousness in their treatment of everybody, and could not like them. Though their kindness to Jane, such as it was, had value as arising in all probability from the influence of their brother's admiration. It was generally evident whenever they met that he did admire her. And to Elizabeth it was equally evident that Jane was yielding to the preference which she had begun to entertain for him from the first, and was, in a way, to be very much in love. But she considered with pleasure that it was not likely to be discovered by the world in general, since Jane united with great strength of feeling a composure of temper and a uniform cheerfulness of manner, which would guard her from the suspicions of the impertinent. Elizabeth mentioned this to her friend, Miss Charlotte Lucas. "It may be pleasant," replied Charlotte, "but it is sometimes a disadvantage to be so very guarded. In 9 cases out of 10, a woman had better show more affection than she feels. Bingley likes your sister, undoubtedly, but he may never do more than like her if she does not help him on."
But she does help him on as much as her nature will allow. If I can perceive her regard for him, he must be a simpleton indeed not to discover it too. Remember, Eliza, that he does not know Jane's disposition as you do. Occupied in observing Mr. Bingley's attentions to her sister, Elizabeth was far from suspecting that she was becoming herself an object of some interest in the eyes of his friend. Mr. Darcy had at first scarcely allowed her to be pretty. He had looked at her without admiration at the ball. And when they next...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.